Penguin Audio presents Kinsey and Me by Sue Grafton. Read by Judy, Kaye. Part 1. Kinsey. Introduction. Kinsey Millhone entered my life like an apparition sometime in 1977. I was living in Columbus, Ohio at the time, writing movies for television while my husband attended Ohio State, working on his PhD. She arrived by degrees, insinuating herself with all the cunning of a stray cat who knew long before I did that she was here to stay. The name came first, the Kinsey I spotted in a copy of The Hollywood Reporter in the little column announcing birth. A couple in Hollywood had named their infant daughter Kinsey, and the name leapt out at me. Millhone was probably the product of a finger stroll through the telephone book or a random matching process, wherein I tried various syllables and rhythms until I found one that suited me. I should note that the novels are set in the 1980s because of the decision I made at the time to have Kinsey age 1 year for every 2.5 books. In A is for Alibi, she's 32 years old. 30 years later, in V is for Vengeance, she's 38. My only other choice was to have her age 1 year for every book, which would mean that if I kept her in real time, she'd be middle-aged by now and less likely to live with such reckless abandon. Since her life proceeds at such a measured pace, I am, myself, caught in a time warp. One obvious consequence of this same decision is that many of the technological advancements in the forensic sciences, and most certainly innovations in communications, are nowhere in evidence. No internet, no cell phones, little DNA testing. This means she's forced to do her sleuthing the old-fashioned way, which better suits her personal style and the needs of the narrative. I originally decided to write about a hard-boiled private eye because those are the books I was raised on. My father, C.W. Grafton, was a municipal bond attorney all his life, but he also wrote and published 3 mystery novels: The Rat Began to Gnaw the Rope, The Rope Began to Hang the Butcher, and Beyond a Reasonable Doubt. Because of him, I developed a real passion for the genre. I elected to write about a female protagonist at the outset because I'm female. Hot news, huh? And I figured it was my one area of expertise. When I started work on A is for Alibi, I wasn't even sure what a private investigator did. In the course of writing that first book, I began the long and continuing task of educating myself. I read books on forensics, toxicology, burglary and theft, homicide, arson, anatomy, and poisonous plants, among many others. My personal library has grown since I began writing about Kinsey, and I now have quite a storehouse of information at my fingertips. The cases I write about are invented, though some owe their inspiration to tidbits gleaned from the crime section of my local newspaper, which I clip from almost daily. I like looking at the dark side of human nature, trying to understand what makes people kill each other instead of going into therapy. In my soul, I'm a real law and order type, and I don't want people to get away with murder. In a mystery novel, there is justice, and I like that a lot. Kinsey is my alter ego, the person I might have been had I not married young and had children. The 68 VW she drove, until G is for Gumshoe, was a car I owned some years ago. In H is for Homicide, she acquires the 1974 VW, which sat in my driveway until I donated it as a raffle item for a local theater group. The lucky ticket holder won the car for her $10 purchase. It was pale blue, with only one minor ding in the left rear fender. I didn't mind Kinsey using the car, but with her driving record, I refused to put her on my insurance policy. What's stimulating about her presence in my life is that since she can know only what I know, I have to do a great deal of research, and this allows me, in essence, to lead 2 lives, hers and mine. Because of her, I've taken a women's self-defense class and a class in criminal law. I've also made the acquaintance of doctors, lawyers, PIs, cops, coroners, and all manner of experts. I own both of her handguns, and in fact, I learned to shoot so that I'd know what it feels like. I own the all-purpose dress she refers to in the books. Like Kinsey, I've been married and divorced twice, though I'm currently married to husband number 3 and intend to remain so for life. The process of writing informs both her life and mine. While our biographies are different, our sensibilities are the same. As I've said on previous occasions, I think of us as one soul in two bodies, and she got the good one. The particulars of her history usually come to me in the moment of writing. Often I feel she's peering over my shoulder, whispering, nudging me, and making body remarks. The humor comes from her, and the acid observations, also whatever tenderness seeps into the page. She is a marvel for which I take only partial credit, though she probably claims all the credit for me. It amuses me that I invented someone who has gone on to support me. It amuses her, I'm sure, that she will live in this world long after I am gone. I trust that you will enjoy her companionship as I have. Sue Grafton. Between the Sheets. I squinted at the woman sitting across the desk from me. I could have sworn she'd just told me there was a dead man in her daughter's bed, which seemed like a strange thing to say, accompanied, as it was, by a pleasant smile and carefully modulated tone. Maybe I'd misunderstood. It was 9 o'clock in the morning, some ordinary day of the week. I was, I confess, hungover, a rare occurrence in my life. I do not drink often or much, but the night before I'd been at a birthday party for my landlord, Henry Pitts, who'd just turned 82. Apparently the celebration had gotten out of hand because here I was, feeling fuzzy-headed and faintly nauseated, trying to look like an especially smart and capable private investigator, which is what I am when I'm in good form. My name is Kinsey Millhone. I'm 32 years old, divorced, a licensed PI, running my own small agency in a town 95 miles north of Los Angeles. The woman had told me her name was Emily Culpepper, and that much made sense. She was very small, one of those women who at any age will be thought cute, God forbid. She had short, dark hair and a sweet face, and she looked like a perfect suburban housewife. She was wearing a pale blue blouse with a Peter Pan collar, a heather-colored Shetland sweater with grosgrain ribbon down the front, a heather tweed skirt, hose, and capesios with a dainty heel. I guessed her to be roughly my age. I reached for my legal pad and a pencil, as though prepared to take important notes. "Excuse me, Mrs. Culpepper, but could I ask you to repeat that?" The pleasant smile became fixed. She leaned forward. "Are you recording this?" she said with alarm. "I mean, can this be used against me in court?"
"I'm just trying to understand what you're talking about," I replied. "I thought you just told me there was a dead man in your daughter's bed. Is that correct?"
She nodded solemnly, her eyes huge. I wrote down, "Dead man in daughter's bed." But I wasn't really sure what to ask next. So many questions crowd about when someone says something like that.
"Do you know the man?"
"Oh, yes. It's Gerald," she said.
I noted the name. "Your husband?"
"My lover," she said. "I'm divorced."
"And where is your daughter at this point?"
"She's with him, my husband. But she's probably on her way home. He really isn't supposed to take her on weekdays. It says so in my decree. But he's been out of town, and I thought it was all right. Just this once."
I'm sure it is, I said, hoping to reassure her on this one small point. And when did you notice? I checked my notes. Gerald?
This morning at about 6. Well, closer to 10 of, actually.
What kind of dead is he?
What?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.